photometric calibration, quality control, and assays for a clinical chemistry analyzer will be our topic. This topic will be separated into four parts. The first part will be a general introduction. The second part will be about photometric calibration. The third part will be about the quality control. And finally, we'll talk about the types of the photometric assays. So now we'll start with a general introduction. In the general introduction, we'll have the following points. The first point will be what are the steps to measure an analyte, for example, glucose, uric acid. So what are the steps if I want to measure the glucose, uric acid, cholesterol, and so on in a patient blood? Matrix effect will be the second point. What is the difference between the patient sample and the synthetic samples, such as a calibrator, quality control, and proficiency testing? Then we'll talk about the product lyophilization process, which is a process used to manufacturing for the manufacturing of calibrators and quality controls in order to lengthen their life during the shipping and storage. Then we'll talk about the reconstitution of a lyophilized product, such as calibrator or a quality control, in a clinical laboratory. Finally, we'll talk about the common analytes for clinical chemistry analyzer Cobas C311, which is manufactured for Roche. So what are the steps to measure an analyte? In order to measure analytes or assays in a patient's blood serum, the following steps should be followed. The step one, a calibration must be made. The second step, a verification of the success of the calibration must be made using a quality control. And finally, the as a third step, the measurement then will be done. Now we'll talk about the matrix effect. So what is the difference between a patient sample, which is considered as a physiological or a natural sample, and between a synthetic sample or artificial sample, such as a calibrator or a quality control or a proficiency testing? Many clinical laboratory methods are affected by the sample matrix, a term for the physiological or artificial environment that contains the analyte. So the environment which contains an analyte is, whether it's a physiological or artificial, is known as the sample matrix. Sometimes two different methods that give the same result for a patient sample may give different result when analyzing synthetic samples, such as calibrator, proficiency testing, and the quality control samples. These synthetic samples should mimic the patient sample. However, many times they do not, because the matrix has undergone a type of manufacturing process, and we will talk about this, and does not resemble a fresh human patient specimen or sample. The manufacturing process aims to stabilize and extend the analyte life during the shipping and storage, but this process changes the matrix of the native human sample. So what is the difference between the patient sample and the synthetic sample? Synthetic samples, such as the calibrator, as we said, a proficiency testing or quality control, differs from a patient sample. Firstly, the synthetic samples are supplemented with many different substances. This because they need to generate wide ranges of analyte concentrations. So in order to generate a wide range of analyte concentrations, so they are supplemented with many different substances. So this is the first difference. The second difference, as we said before, to extend the life of the synthetic samples, such as calibrator or control, during the shipping and the due to the need to ship from one country to another, and also the need to store it in the supplier as well as in the hospital or a medical center. Such synthetic samples are either frozen or lyophilized, and we will talk about what is lyophilization to minimize the decomposition of the analytes during either, as we said, shipping or storage. This is a process of freezing or lyophilization followed by thawing or reconstitution of with a liquid may also change the properties of the solution. So due to the need for the shipping of these synthetic samples from the manufacturer to the client, there will be a shipping and there will be a storage period or shelf period either in the manufacturer store or in the supplier store or even in the healthcare facility store such as a hospital or a medical center. For this, we make a process to in order to extend the life of this extended to extend the life of these synthetic samples. This process either will be a frozen or a lyophilization, frozing or lyophilization. And this, when this process should be reversed at a clinical laboratory by through thawing or reconstitution, this will lead to the change of the properties of the solution. So this is the this results in a difference between a natural sample, which is a patient sample, and artificial or synthetic sample, such as a calibrator, quality control, or proficiency testing. So the addition of extra substances or freezing or lyophilization alters the solution properties in a way that biases the measured result. The bias is said to result from a matrix effect. So this is a matrix effect, and we should consider this matrix effect during the calibration process or the verification of this calibration by a quality control. Now, as we can see here in this slide, we have different types of calibrators. We have liquid calibrator, we have lyophilized calibrator. So what is lyophilization, which is used in order to extend the life shelf of the calibrators? Now we'll watch a small video which demonstrates what is the lyophilization process. This process will be separated into four steps. The first step will be the freezing at minus 60 degree with at also 1 bar. Then the second step will be a primary drying with a vacuum effect at a plus 5 temperature. The third step will be a secondary drying, which should be done also at a temperature 20 degree with a vacuum effect. Finally, sealing and capping will be done. So now we'll watch this video. So the first step will be the freezing. This should be done at 1 bar and minus 60 degree for a certain period of time. The second step will be the primary drying, which will be at 0.1 millibar, which is a vacuum, and a temperature plus 5 degree. The third step will be the secondary drying, will be at a 0.03 millibar vacuum and at a temperature plus 20 degree. The last step or will be the sealing and capping of this vials. So this is known as a product lyophilization process, which is used, as we said, to extend the life to extend the life shelf of a calibrator or quality control or any synthetic sample.
Many of our products are...
Now we'll see the reconstitution of a lyophilized product, such as a quality control or calibrator, at a clinical laboratory and how this should be done. This lyophilized product, in this case, will be the protein.
Provided lyophilized to ensure stability during shipping and on the shelf. These products are all provided with a certificate of analysis, or C of A, that contains our recommended reconstitution concentration and buffer formulation. This information can be found here. To ensure optimal recovery, it is recommended to reconstitute all products to the concentrations listed with the specified buffer. R&D Systems offers a helpful reconstitution calculator at www.rndsystems.com/calculators. This tool helps you easily calculate the correct volume of buffer every time. The calculator can also be found on each product-specific page. When you're ready to reconstitute, first allow both the vial and the buffer to come to room temperature.
So, as we said before, in order to reconstitute, we need the vial, which is for the lyophilized product, and also we need the buffer, which is the liquid used to reconstitute this lyophilized product.
Temperature. Once at room temperature, we recommend performing a quick spin in a centrifuge. This ensures that all the lyophilized pellet is in the bottom of the tube. You can lightly tap down the vial if it does not fit into the centrifuge you have available. Now you are ready to add the buffer. If you do not have the necessary buffer on hand, R&D Systems offers a ready-to-use buffer specific to your protein or antibody at www.rndsystems.com/reconstitutionbuffers. Using the volume you calculated using the reconstitution calculator, slowly add the buffer to the vial to achieve the desired concentration. Gently agitate the vial to ensure thorough reconstitution of the lyophilized product. When mixing, avoid shaking, pipetting, and vortexing. This can result in protein loss or denaturation. The powder should be entirely dissolved within 15 to 30 minutes. Flakes and particulates may appear in your solution. If this happens, mix the product at room temperature for 2 to 3 hours or overnight at 4 degrees Celsius on a rocker platform. Your product is now ready to use. If you are not ready to use your product just...
So, this is how to reconstitute a lyophilized product at a clinical laboratory. Now we'll move to the last point in the introduction, which will be about the common analytes which are used for the Cobas C300 analyzer, which is manufactured for Roche Diagnostic. These are the tests which are to be analyzed using such analyzer. First, we have the substrates. We have also enzymes, electrolytes, drugs of abuse. Also, we have proteins, TDM, and finally, others. So this is the first part of the photometric calibration, quality control, and assays. Now we'll move to the second part, which will be the photometric calibration. Thank you.